Well, hello, folks, and welcome to this live virtual forum with Mayor Karen Bass, along with Deputy Mayor Rachel Freeman, Deputy Mayor Randall Winston, Deputy Mayor Brian Williams, Deputy Mayor Karen Lane, and Chief of Housing Mercedes Marquez. We just have a few folks on right now, but we're dialing out to thousands. In a moment here, Mayor Bass will provide updates to begin our forum tonight. As you listen, think about questions you might like to submit for the Q&A that will follow. When you do have a question to submit for Q&A, press 0 on your phone to get that question to an operator. Your operator will take down some notes on your question. Then you'll have the opportunity to ask your question live. If you prefer not to ask your question live, just let your operator know that, and we can read it live instead. Again, we have Mayor Karen Bass, along with Deputy Mayor Rachel Freeman, Deputy Mayor Randall Winston, Deputy Mayor Brian Williams, Deputy Mayor Karen Lane, and Chief of Housing Mercedes Marquez here to provide updates and answer your questions tonight. So tune in as Mayor Bass gets you up to speed on important issues. And remember, you can press 0 to submit a question for Q&A at any time during this live forum. That'll take you to an operator. They'll take down some notes on your question, and we'll take as many questions as we can in the time we have tonight. Remember, you can also press 7 to give us your email address to get email updates from the mayor moving forward. So again, press 0 to submit your questions for Q&A, and we're going to go ahead and begin live now. If you're listening to this forum in English and you prefer to listen in Spanish, press 8 now, and that'll transfer you to our Spanish simulcast. Again, if you're listening in English but you prefer to listen in Spanish, press 8 now to transfer to our Spanish simulcast. And with that, it's my pleasure to introduce Mayor Karen Bass to get us started. Go ahead, please, Mayor.
Well, hello, Los Angeles. This is Mayor Karen Bass coming to you from City Hall. And for those of you that have never done this before, when I was in Congress, we used to do telephone town halls to constituents regularly. And what it is that it's an opportunity for us to call thousands of Angelenos and for you to have an opportunity to talk to me directly and to ask your questions. So this is our introductory call, trying to see if we can do this citywide, like we used to do in my congressional district. Well, it's hard for me to believe, but I've actually been mayor now for 9 months. Some days it feels like it's been 2 years, and some days it feels like it's just been a month. The time is going by so fast. I can't tell you how excited and rewarded that I have been, especially through what we're doing to get Angelenos out of those tents and into housing. We know that we have more people on our streets than any other city in the country. And I'm happy that the President of the United States recognized that by choosing us to be one of 5 cities to focus on. And so we've been going out. If you live near an encampment, you might have hopefully seen that encampment disappear. We have proven over these 9 months that people want to get off the street. They don't want to live in tents. We have not had a problem getting people to leave the tents. And one of the reasons is because we have excellent leadership here in City Hall. We have a chief of housing and homelessness named Mercedes Marquez. She used to be the assistant secretary of HUD under the Obama administration. I'm going to introduce her in a second. But I want you to know that we have gotten more than 1,500 people off the street. We have done 26 different inside safe operations, moving people off the streets and into housing. And we're going to continue to do that until we have ended street homelessness. I want you to know that in these 9 months, we have been able to get more than 17,000 Angelenos to come inside. Inside Safe is one program, but we have other programs to do that as well. So let me turn this over to Chief Mercedes Marquez. And when she's done, I'm going to come back and talk to you about how getting people off the streets is one thing, but we need to prevent people from becoming homeless, period. Take it away, Chief Marquez.
Good evening, everybody. Buenas noches a todos. I'm so happy to be here with you, with the mayor and my fellow counterparts in the mayor's office. As the mayor said, over 17,000 Angelenos have come inside, and we are doing that in a variety of ways. First, we're making more vouchers available. I don't know if you know what that means, but over at the Housing Authority, the federal government and others provide dollars that we can turn into kind of stipends for housing. And we're working hard to make those move faster, to make people qualify. We've gotten help from the federal government to get waivers so that we don't have to prove so many kind of sometimes ridiculous types of requirements. So we're doing that. We're also making permanent housing available faster. We're building faster. We're cutting red tape so that we move through the planning process in a more efficient way. Last week, we announced that over 7,000 units of affordable housing are being expedited as a result of an executive director that the mayor signed in her first week in office. That means that approvals now that used to take 6 months are now just taking over 40 days. And you know what they say, time is money. And if we can get these things built faster, more effectively, more efficiently, not only do we get people housed, we also save money that goes toward building extra housing. So that all is, you know, what we're about. We have done this with folks in the White House, absolutely helping us, as the mayor said, to partner as they work to decrease their goal of homelessness, right? Decreasing homelessness by 25%. If we focus here, we're that 25% all by ourselves. We're also working on renter's assistance. And that means that the city council in the mayor's budget passed $150 million to help keep Angelenos in their homes. So I'd like you to write down if you need some help with renter protections. We also have a small fund available to help people with back rent. So this is where you can call. The application is still open for rentals assistance. You would look online at housing.lacity.org, or you can call 888-379-3150. You can apply there. They're in all kinds of languages, so feel free to call. There are different translators to help. So we want to be clear. If all that money goes to the landlords so that you aren't out evicted, but also to help small landlords, small businesses stay afloat. So that's the kind of stuff we're looking at. We're also working for further assistance with 15 in-person family source centers that are set up and available for one-on-one assistance to help you complete the application, also in different languages. And they can also help you enroll in other services that are available through our systems, like helping you pay utilities, enrollment in public benefits, relocation assistance, pre-employment and employment support, financial coaching, even help you prepare your income taxes, ESL classes, computer literacy. All these things are free to low-income Angeleno residents. So take advantage of it. The Family Source Centers, you can find them also through housing.lacity.org by calling 888-379-3150. We really, really encourage you all to take advantage of everything we're doing. We know people need the help, and the mayor has, like, is pulling for you. We are pulling for you. So please apply.
Thank you, Chief. I appreciate that. And you know what? I'm going to take some questions right now. Let me just say to Deputy Mayor Karen Lane, I'm going to call on you in a minute, okay, because there's a question for you. So someone is asking, will there be any protection for the February 1st back due rent? That is Laura from Playa Vista. Laura, you know, there is an organization called the Mayor's Fund. You can call them at 213-584-1808, 213-584-1808, or you can visit Mayor's Fund LA, and fund is FUNDLA, Mayor's, MAYORS. We do have assistance for people who are facing eviction. We can give you information on tenant protection, and we can also hopefully connect you up with a lawyer, if pro bono lawyers that we are recruiting. So let me just say, Karen Lane, Jason from North Hollywood is wondering about the city council creating an unarmed crisis response and they want to know if there's any progress being made on that. Deputy Mayor Lane, if you are available, can you answer that question? How are we doing with unarmed response?
Good evening, Mayor. Good evening, everyone. Yes, the City Council has dedicated resources to standing up an office for unarmed response, as well as allocating resources to pilot a unarmed response effort in the City of Los Angeles. It is still in progress. Those contracts are being executed for those services across the city, and the City Council would support from the mayor's office, as well as the CAO's office, is continuing to build the infrastructure to support that work. In the meantime, the mayor's office continues to administer the CERCLE program, which is a civilian crisis response program that responds to 911 calls, as well as calls to ask LAPD that involve unhoused populations and very low nonviolent activity. We work to deploy mental health clinicians as well as practitioners with lived experience to de-escalate those situations, as well as to connect residents to services who need them. But the city is actively working to build more capacity to have more unarmed and civilian-led crisis response efforts.
Thank you very much, Deputy Mayor. I appreciate that. We're very excited about our work with the City Council. We've been working very well. You know, one of the things that really kind of characterized the city a lot was infighting between the city, the county, the mayor's office, the council, and we've really been bringing people together so that we stop all of that, because that just that takes us away from getting the job done. So I want to read a couple of other questions, and I think Deputy Mayor Jared Rivera, here is a question for you. Beverly from LA is saying, I would like to get to the grassroots, your constituents. What can we do to help? Let's help Beverly figure out how she can connect to you and the incredible work that you're doing in the neighborhoods.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, and hello, Beverly, and that is music to my ears. So hi, everyone. My name is Jared Rivera, the Deputy Mayor of Community Engagement. That is a great question, Beverly, and really that is, I think, the theme of what the mayor has been leading in the city and what our administration is focused on. Which is to say that we cannot achieve all of these different goals that we have. We cannot transform this city unless all of us are in it together. So we want to connect directly with communities. We want to tap into folks like you who are connected to your neighbors. You may be connected to a church, a synagogue, a mosque. You may be connected to PTA groups. And we want to make sure that we are hearing from you about what is going on, and also sharing information about how you can get involved. After this call, if you're on here right now, we're going to text out a link to everyone, which is a very, very short survey, which is going to let us know a little bit about you. So if you would just look for that link as soon as it goes out, if you fill that out, we will have someone on our team reach out. But really, we cannot do this without all of us being in here together. So I look forward to working with you and your neighbors and everyone on this call.
Folks, this is Zach Seidel, Deputy Mayor of Communications. Ian, I believe we're going to take a poll.
Yes, absolutely. So, folks, if you would like to receive text messages from the mayor's office to get updates, press 1 on your phone right now. Again, if you'd like to get text messages from the mayor's office, you can let us know just by pressing 1 on your phone right now. We'll go ahead and keep that running for the next couple of minutes, so you can press 1 to let us know. Thanks, Zach.
And let me just tell you, if you get text messages from us, we won't be selling anything, okay? It'll just be giving you information that I believe will help the neighborhood. So Detroit asked, he said, so there are housing vouchers. He he has a two-bedroom voucher and he can't move forward because it's not enough to pay the rent and also an initial deposit. So, Detroit, let me tell you, please call our office at 213-978-0600, 213-978-0600, and give us all of your information so that we can reach out to you and get you the appropriate counseling and help that you need. Kathy Ocampo, you're from Canova Park. You don't think anything's being done in the west end of the San Fernando Valley. I am so sorry. I don't want you to feel like you're an afterthought. That's what you wrote in the queue. Let me just tell you that we actually have been in the valley quite a lot. We've been dealing with a number of very difficult encampments in Bob Blumenfeld's district. We were just there the other day. We housed over 50 people. And also in Imelda, the new councilwoman, Padilla's district, we were there and we cleared an encampment there. And I'll tell you, this has just been so rewarding because we haven't been just moving the encampment and say, you know, you go over here, clean the streets, and then people come right back. The encampments we've cleared, people have not come back. They have stayed in the motels. And so I'm sorry you feel that way. We will make sure that we go to Canoga Park. I know your councilman is Blumenfeld, so we'll make sure that we send some love to Canoga Park. So David is asking, what can you do to stop the drugs on Metro and how you can stop tagging? I'm going to tell you that one role I'm playing now is I'm chairing Metro. And so I tell you, when I first went to Metro meetings, I was surprised that 90% of what we talk about is homelessness and substance abuse. So we have definite plans to set up safe storage for RVs in Metro's property, maybe some of the lots, the land that Metro owns. But also we're looking at building supportive services near Metro so that we can house people, so that people won't try to use the Metro as housing or Metro stations. And so you saw the ambassador programs. You see the ambassadors everywhere. That's one of the new innovations that we're doing. So just I want to tell you that we are absolutely going to address this problem, and it comes up in every single Metro meeting. So let me introduce one of our next deputy mayors. We have a deputy mayor for public safety, Brian Williams. Brian, please take it away for what we're doing to keep LA safe. And you might specifically mention the smash and grabs that we know is causing people an awful lot of stress.
Thank you, Mayor, and good evening to everyone here in Los Angeles land. You know, one of the most important jobs, I believe, for any mayor of any major city is to keep our community safe. And that's certainly something that the mayor has instructed us to do, and we're giving every effort to do that, exactly that, to keep our city safe. It's been reported widely in the media recently that there have been a number of smash-and-grab robberies, and we've taken some steps to address this problem. Several weeks ago, the mayor, along with LAPD and other regional agencies, established a smash-and-grab task force. I'm happy to report tonight that we've arrested almost 50 people since this has launched, and there are more arrests that are on the way. I also want to thank the governor for his assistance and the state legislature for the funding that they're sending to the Los Angeles community to help us fund some additional officers on overtime to address this issue that seems to be very widely reported. And we're hoping to resolve this sometime soon. LAPD is very good at this. You know, when we talk about public safety, it's not just police and fire, but it's also emergency management. And I do want to mention just for a second, we had some unprecedented events in Los Angeles recently. Of course, we had a hurricane, and then we had an earthquake during the hurricane. The mayor mentioned the other day, hopefully we won't have locusts. So I'm hoping that's the case, Mayor, we won't have any locusts. But I'm very proud to say how well the mayor and our emergency management department and our great fire chief worked together to make sure that Los Angeles was prepared for that event and that we're prepared for earthquakes. And I want to remind our local public to be prepared for emergencies as well. Having an emergency kit at home, knowing what to do in the event of an earthquake, knowing where the exits are in case of a fire, that's really important to us. Finally, if I can just mention, it's been widely reported that we have just signed a new contract with LAPD. You know, for the first time in any number of years, We've had a reduction of officers below 9,000 officers in Los Angeles, so that's an untenable position for us. We're also having great difficulty, as many departments are across the nation, indeed across the world, in filling the ranks of their departments. This contract that was passed by the City Council will go a long way toward increasing the number of recruits that we have coming into LAPD. In fact, in August, the LAPD said they had just over 1,000 people who applied, and that was the largest amount of applications in a single month since September of 2020. So getting the ranks of LAPD filled is important to us. Working with Karen Lane and the Community Safety Office is important to us as we reimagine what public safety looks like in our community. And again, we're making every effort to make Los Angeles the safest big city in America.
Thank you very much, Deputy Mayor Williams. And I'm going to put Deputy Mayor Lane back on in a minute to talk about some other areas of community safety in a few minutes. But let me just read Ryan. Ryan from downtown L.A., he says a lot of L.A. communities feel that certain neighborhoods are being severely affected by homelessness. That's for sure. How is the city going to share the burden of homelessness across all the neighborhoods while preserving equity? You know, that is at the center of my administration. You should know that. I would love for you to see, and we can figure out how to put it on our website so you can see where we have housed people from encampments and the encampments are gone and haven't come back. I will tell you that if we had enough motel rooms, I know that we could get significantly reduce street homelessness, because again, people are not refusing to go in. People are looking forward to going in. And you know, the motel rooms are expensive, but I want you to know that just think about how much it costs for people to be on the street. One of the other callers talked about homeless people or homeless encampments being the source of fires. And I know when I've met with our fire department, they will talk about the number one reason they're going around town fighting fires is fires connected to homelessness. So leaving people on the street costs way more than housing them. But we are looking for cheaper ways than the motels. So now we're looking at purchasing hotels. You might have seen that we purchased one downtown. So you need to know that this is front and center, and all of the calls that have written in where you're asking questions about homelessness, know that this really is the centerpiece of our agenda. It obviously is not the only thing we are doing. In a minute, I'm going to call on Deputy Mayor Freeman, and I want her to tell you about what we're doing in the business community. So Deputy Mayor Lane, can you quickly come back on and talk about GRID and also the Summer Night Lights?
Absolutely. I am the mayor of community safety, the mayor's office of community safety, deputy mayor. And we, through the mayor's office of community safety, we support community-based efforts that are proven to reduce crime and violence in the communities and neighborhoods. And one of the mayor's initiatives is the Gang Reduction and Youth Development Program that really focuses resources to disrupt cycles of violence, and to support community violence intervention, both for youth and adults. This year, we have been able to distribute nearly $60 million to support community violence intervention, as well as youth and adult reentry services to reduce recidivism and to break cycles of violence and crime. This summer, we successfully held Summer Night Lights across 40 sites throughout the city of Los Angeles. Through Summer Night Lights, we were able to provide nearly 400 Angelenos, both youth and adults, with employment opportunities. They worked throughout the summer. Two beautiful things happened this summer during Summer Night Lights. Not only did we provide employment opportunities, but we really created spaces for communities to come together and build community cohesion. So in many parks, especially in the San Fernando Valley, we had not only nonprofit organizations working together with recreation and parks to provide robust programming, sports, and opportunities for youth and adults, but we also had neighbors and residents in the community do potlucks in those parks So we had things on the grills, but we also had, the mothers and fathers and uncles and aunties to come into the park and break bread with one another. And as a result, we were able to reduce violence and crime in those areas. And even in instances where we had incidences of violence, we were able as a city to support those communities, not only the victims and survivors of those incidents and their families, but we also immediately did canvassing in neighborhoods that were impacted by violence to talk to residents to ensure that they felt seen and heard in this city. We also provided mental health services to those residents in those neighborhoods that were impacted by violence. We provided healing circles at recreation and park sites so that we could talk about our trauma and talk about our healing together. And so we are really excited that we are increasing the city's capacity to support communities in their healing process. And so we look forward to continue to work with neighborhoods and communities to work together around safety. We will soon start a community engagement process where we will have listening sessions in neighborhoods across the city, as well as supporting polling and surveys through the digital platforms where we can get residents' input on, one, their perceptions of safety in their neighborhood, but also what they want to see in their neighborhood to make themselves feel safer and to their families to feel and be safer in their communities. So we're really excited about that work.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And, listening to our Deputy Mayor Williams and Lane, I think the most important thing, and I always say this, if crime happens, you have to stop it, period. But I also believe in preventing crime before it happens. And that's the difference between Deputy Mayor Williams and Deputy Mayor Lane. How do we prevent crime in the same way that we want to get people off the streets, but we also want to prevent people from ever becoming homeless? That's what the focus of the Mayor's Fund. Please Google Mayor's Fund LA to get information on it. You know of somebody that is facing eviction, how we might prevent that eviction from moving into homelessness. So we've talked a lot about homelessness, and we could continue doing that, but I also want to lift up some other areas of the administration. We know that one of our fundamental issues in the city is that the city has just become unaffordable. And so in order to address that, we need to have jobs that pay more, and we need to have housing that is affordable. So toward that end, we have Deputy Mayor Rachel Freeman. She is the Deputy Mayor of Business and Economic Development, and I want her to share a few words with you about how we are strengthening small businesses in our community, because we know that small businesses employ the majority of Angelenos. So take it away, Deputy Mayor Freeman.
Thank you so much, Mayor Bass, and good evening, everyone. As noted, Mayor Bass signed her executive directive to support small business growth in our city. And small businesses make up nearly 99% of the businesses here. And so, this initiative is incredibly timely. As we know, businesses are really trying to recover in a post-pandemic landscape. And, to date through ED4, we've really concentrated our efforts on expediting the time that it takes for businesses to open their doors. And we've been working with departments to create action plans to not only focus on implementation of long-term solutions that are needed, but also the short-term solutions that address problems with the urgency that's required, because we recognize that just one day that a business is not able to open equates to one day of revenue loss. And so I'm proud to share that we are already taking action on some of these recommendations through this directive. We've been working towards addressing additional barriers to ensure that small business interaction with the city is expedited, is seamless, and we're working to create an ecosystem that supports rather than creates additional obstacles. And to that end, I'm really excited to share that we will be announcing and providing a summary report of our initial findings of Executive Directive 4 on Saturday, October 14th at the Los Angeles Business and Financial Empowerment Summit, which is a free event that I invite all businesses and business owners to attend. This summit is going to provide economic growth within the city by equipping business owners and entrepreneurs with really valuable information, connecting them to resources, insights into government contracting, and tools to really enhance their financial health as a business. This expo will include over 100 resource providers, keynote speakers, panel discussions, and incredible network opportunities. So I encourage everyone to please RSVP for this free event at bit.ly/LA Empowerment Summit. Again, that's bit.ly/LA Empowerment Summit. And I'll share with you that this is already our second small business summit since the mayor took office 9 months ago. And simply put, we know how important it is for us to connect with our business community on a regular basis to provide resources and assistance that they need to thrive. To further show our commitment to the small business community, we have already established a small business and policy team within my office focused on identifying the challenges and opportunities to support our small business community. This team is not only seeking to support the business community through Executive Directive 4, but we're also trying to connect small businesses and those organizations to ensure that our office is always up to date with the challenges that businesses are facing, and we're working tirelessly to implement solutions to help find ways for businesses to better benefit from their interaction with the city, including through procurement. And so if you own a business or you're interested in contracting with the city, please visit rampla.org. Again, that's rampla.org to access contracting opportunities from the city as well as our regional partners through one platform. Going forward, we plan on building on those actions and policies that promote small business growth, inclusion, and ensuring that all businesses benefit from the nearly $4.5 billion that the city spends annually on procurement. So with that, I look forward to seeing you all at the LA Business and Empowerment Summit on Saturday, October 14th. And Mayor Bath, I'll pass it back to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mayor Freeman. And let me just say for folks that might not know, you know, an executive directive allows me to essentially order the city to do something where I'm not going through city council because I'm not a member of the council. So it's a way for me to enact policy. You see, the president is called an executive order. When the president can't get something through Congress, then he does an executive order. And by the way, I know we're waiting to see if the government is going to shut down. But I want you to know I'm holding out hope that that's not going to happen. I talked to Speaker Pelosi today, and she is hopeful. So even though it looks like we're down to the wire, I have hope that the government won't shut down and that the Republicans will figure out how to not compromise our city. I still call her Speaker. Somebody's holding up a sign saying Speaker Emeritus. Krishna from Pacific Palisades, you are very concerned about understaffing of first responder roles, and you're wondering if the mayor's office has considered opening up legal immigration. Let me just tell you something. You know, we have like about 7,000 vacancies in the city, and I actually think that we can fill a lot of those vacancies with people here who need jobs or people who are working and need better jobs. Because if you work for the city, you get a pension, you get benefits. You know, there's a lot of reasons to come and work for the city. So one of the things that I've been working on since being here is how to speed up the hiring process. In a minute, I'm going to call on Deputy Mayor Winston so he can talk about city services, and he can explain to everyone why it takes a while for your trash to be picked up or the potholes to be fixed, because we have vacancies in all of those areas. So, you know, I don't actually feel we need to bring in people from outside of the country. I think that we have enough people here who need better paying jobs, but we just need to make LA an easier place to get a job in. It shouldn't take you 6 months to get hired. And then Louie from downtown is wondering about the care court. You know, the care court is how we can deal with people who are profoundly mentally ill. And I know that everybody has seen this. There's people who are dying on our streets every day. They're so ill that they don't know that they're ill. And I happen to believe that it is inhumane to let people die on the street. And so the care court is supposed to be a way that we can help people who are profoundly mentally ill. by doing a conservatorship, which means that they might be hospitalized without their permission because they don't know that they are ill. So we're going to see if this works. But I will tell you that in the next election, there's going to be two ballot initiatives dealing with mental health. And I hope one that is going to allow for our county to spend more money on mental health services. And also it will be a bond so that we can build more mental health facilities. Because right now we don't have places to take people. And I'm sure everybody on this call is aware that the nation's most expensive mental health facility is in downtown L.A. And unfortunately, it's called the jail. And I happen to think that it is also inhumane to incarcerate people who are mentally ill. If you're ill, you need medical help. You do not need to be incarcerated, nor do you need to be a victim on the streets. So, Deputy Mayor Winston, why don't you talk about your areas of work? And also, of course, you can take this time to do a pitch because you need a lot of employees in your area.
Thank you so much, Mayor, and good evening, everyone. It really is a pleasure to speak with you all. As the mayor noted, we are working every day to make sure our city services are not only in top shape, but really that they're resolved more quickly and in a more timely manner. And I'll start just by level setting. We know that we have substantial backlogs for a host of city services, and that is what we are laser focused on improving and building on top of, again, addressing requests more quickly. The mayor committed increased funding in his past budget for sidewalk repairs, access ramps, tree trimming, bus shelters, along with other parts of our public right-of-way that are critical for making our streets more livable and our communities, the places in which we all live, more vibrant and healthier. We've got to get more people in those positions to do that work, as the mayor mentioned. And we are addressing those vacancies in a number of ways. Every other month, the Board of Public Works is hosting career fairs, and including one coming up in October. More details are going to be released here shortly, but these will include and do include on-the-spot interviews, representation by every member of the city family, every department, with applications that you can fill out also on the spot. And we are monitoring and making sure that as those applications make their way through the process, they're done more quickly, and that we can get folks in those positions as rapidly as possible to bring down our vacancy rates. We're also working proactively to address our most requested services. What this means is working closely with our Board of Public Works, the Department of Transportation, and Recreation and Parks to improve how we meet constituent services and plan for our and budget for repairs. I'll use one example here. We know chronic dumping is a major problem throughout the city, and it's of course not new. In Watts, for example, there's been chronic dumping along train tracks and in alleys for many years. The mayor earlier this summer charged our Bureau of Sanitation with developing and implementing a more proactive approach. And what that looks like is having our city employees alter the shifts they work throughout the day to be able to respond to complaints for illegal dumping more rapidly. And in many instances in less than 24 hours, because they can respond after hours, after the normal workday. We're partnering in Watts with, the council office, but Union Pacific Railroad as well, to be able to more quickly access areas along the public the railroad and community-based organizations. So we are looking to see how we can improve the speed with which we reply to all of your requests. And I'm going to close with one very important reminder: to request bulky item collection, graffiti removal, reporting street lighting problems, potholes, of course, or illegal dumping, parking enforcement, animal services, really any of our many city services, you can call 311 or request a service online through myla311.lacity.org. We have a call center through 311 that is open Monday through Friday, 7 a.m. until 7 p.m., and on weekends and holidays from 8 a.m. to 4:45 p.m. So we look forward to hearing from you. Please give us a call. We are here to serve. I'll hand it back to you, Mayor.
Thank you very much, Deputy Mayor Winston. Now, Randy from District 4, your question is, how many billions of dollars are you spending on housing 1,500 people? We are not spending billions of dollars. But I will tell you, it is expensive to have people in motels. But it is extremely expensive to leave people on the street to deal with fires, to deal with the compromise of businesses, the quality of life. A lot of people in neighborhoods report criminal activity around encampments, especially drug-related. So when I go out, when I'm talking to our outreach team and they're talking with the neighbors, the amount of stress that's caused in neighborhoods that have encampments and the amount of stress that people in those tents feel, I think it's a question as to what do we want to do in the city? How do we get people off the street so that they don't come back? And what had been happening is we were just moving people. It was a shell game. We'd move them, we'd clean up the area, and then surprise, surprise, they came back. When we house people, they are not coming back. Damon, you said that you were on from South LA. You were on a panel with Councilman Price about homeless encampment strategies, and that there's a bill that's being considered by the city council that would ban the sale of RVs, knowing that someone will be using it to camp on the street with. Well, let me tell you, Damon, I'm not sure about that particular motion that the council has, but I want you to know that we are planning two things with RVs. One, we would like to get people out of the RVs because I think a lot of people know the majority of folks in those RVs do not own them. There's always bottom feeders everywhere, and they are these people called landlords who are essentially renting the RVs out. But for some people who own the RVs and actually want to continue living in them, we want to figure out a place where we can have safe parking so that essentially there'll be 24-hour security, there'll be hygiene, there'll be ways to dispose of waste and services. And so we're looking at anything and everything that will allow us to address the problem of 46,000 people in Los Angeles being on the street. How do we get them off the street safely? How do we clear up our streets so that kids can walk down the sidewalk and go to school and not have to walk in the street? So let me just say, Kirk, can I give it back to you? I'd like for you to repeat the first poll question, and then why don't you ask the second one as well?
Sure, yeah. Let's run that first one more time real quick, and we're just going to ask folks if you'd like to receive a text message from the mayor's office to be kept updated. You can press 1 real quick. Again, if you'd like to receive text messages from the mayor's office to be updated, go ahead and press 1 real quick on your phone right now if you haven't already. We're going to ask our next question of you. We're going to ask how you found out about this town hall. So let me load that one up, and we'll run that one next here. Again, we're just wondering how you found out about this town hall meeting. Press 1 on your phone if you did via email. Press 2 if you found out by text. And press 3 if you found out by a physical letter. So, again, if you found out about this telephone town hall via email, press 1. Via text, press 2. Via physical letter, press 3. Now, back to you, Mayor.
Thank you very much. And for those of you that joined us later, let me just say that, you know, when I was a member of Congress, I did these telephone town halls all the time, and people really liked them. It was an opportunity for people to talk directly to me. It was an opportunity for me to share what was happening in Congress. And so we are experimenting with this particular call. We want to know if this is something that we can apply citywide. And so we would love your feedback. That's why we want to know things like, do you want a text message? And I promised earlier we will not send you any advertisements. This is just to let you know about what is going on in the city. And then we're trying to see how you found out about this because we're looking for a way, we're looking for the best way to reach out to you. And I know that our Deputy Mayor, Jared Rivera, is looking for some volunteers. And so, Kirk, maybe in a few minutes you can do that question about if you are interested in being a volunteer, how you can participate because we really want to get people involved in a lot of different programs that we're going to be building, because the problems that we're facing in our city, I want you to know that even though I'm going to try to work every hour of my day, none of us on this call, none of the deputy mayors, nobody in the city can solve these problems on our own. We need the participation of Angelenos around the city. Everybody needs to have skin in the game. Let me mention to B and Valley Glen, you're asking about the Great Wall mural. You're the Great Wall director, and you're having difficulty with Parks and Recs on getting right of entry. I want you to know that this was recently brought to my attention, and I'm going to work with Deputy Mayor Winston on this. So I got all the information about the Great Wall, and I want you to know that my office is going to be on it so we can resolve whatever the problem is. Kirk, are you prepared to ask that third question?
Absolutely. Got it queued up now. So, folks, we're scaling up our volunteer program. We want to know, would you be interested in learning about opportunities when they become available? Press 1 on your phone for yes and 2 for no. Again, we are scaling up our volunteer programs. Would you be interested in learning about opportunities when they become available? Press 1 on your phone for yes and 2 for no. And, Mayor, we'll leave that running for a few seconds here.
Okay, so in a minute, I'm going to call on our Deputy Mayor for Communications. He's going to give us a report on the environment. But let me just say, for people that joined our call late, I am very happy to say that we've gotten 17,000 Angelenos off the streets this year who have come inside, and we're going to continue. We've had over 26 Inside Safe operations, but you need to know that we're doing Inside Safe is one program. There's a lot of different programs to deal with the unhoused. Inside Safe is what kind of gets all the attention, and sometimes the press reports it like that is the homeless initiative. But we are addressing homelessness in a comprehensive manner. And the number one thing we have to do is stop people from becoming homeless in the first place. So I want you to know that we have a separate organization that is devoted full time to this. It is called the Mayor's Fund, and fund is F-U-N-D. Please reach out to us at mayorsfundla.org. M-A-Y-O-R-S, F as in Frank, U-N-D-L-A.org. You can call us at 213-584-1808, 213-584-1808. If you are facing eviction, if you already have been evicted, please reach out to us. If you have back rent, now we have money in the budget for back rent, but I will tell you that it's going fast. We have a lot of applications, but if you want to reach out to us for rental assistance. Now, rental assistance, understand, does not go to the renter. It goes to your landlord, so that your landlord then has to agree that they can't just take the back rent and then evict you. But that's what we're doing. That's a program, comprehensive way to address the unhoused. So let me turn it over to our Deputy Mayor for Communication, who is going to talk about what we have done so far on the environment.
So hello, Los Angeles. We're obviously every day dealing with the climate crisis, especially, you know, for the first time a month ago, the city braced itself for a tropical storm for the first time in decades. So the mayor put out a very exciting announcement yesterday about progress made on this incredibly crucial issue, and some of the developments are threefold. One, we're making a lot of progress on electrifying the transportation system, and that also involves electrifying our city services. In August, Los Angeles launched the very first 100% electric full-size street sweeper in the entire country, and it's incredibly important here to us at City Hall to continue leading on this issue. We're also increasing energy affordability with energy efficiency and by building in a cleaner way. So as we're building more, it's important that we're building in clean ways. There are more than 100 projects in the pipeline right now in the Comprehensive Affordable Multifamily Retrofits Program through LADWP that was created to support low-income multifamily property owners and residents who want to expand their energy efficiency and install local solar on their rooftops. And the final part is just general progress towards running on 100% clean power. We've applied for approximately $825 million in federal funding to advance clean energy goals here in Los Angeles, because again, confronting the climate crisis is definitely a priority for not only the mayor, but also for City Hall. And I'll pass it back to the mayor.
Okay, let me just repeat those numbers as we're going to be wrapping up here shortly. If you need rental assistance, you could reach housing.lacity.org, or you can call 888-379-3150, 888-379-3150. If you want to report an encampment, you can go to 311, or you can visit myla311.lacity.org. I want to thank everyone for being on this call. We really want to see if this is a way that you would like to hear from my office. I want to find ways to be as accessible to you as possible. I wish I could go all around the city and do town halls like I used to do in the congressional district, but obviously that is a very difficult thing to do. So we're always looking for ways to communicate. I think I'm going to call on our deputy mayor for community engagement again to promote volunteers, people getting involved. And you know, all of us want to see an end to homelessness, but the only way we're going to do that is for Angelenos all around the city to have skin in the game. And that means identifying in your neighborhood where you think housing should be built. I don't want to just impose housing and bulldoze neighborhoods. I want neighborhoods, elected officials, community leaders, faith leaders to come together, recognize we have a problem in the city, and together decide what is the best way to address this problem in our particular neighborhood. Deputy Mayor Rivera, are you still on the line?
I'm here, Madam Mayor. And yes, as the mayor said, it is absolutely critical that we all have skin in the game, as she said, and that we all are together engaging in this. There are just so many different problems and opportunities that we have in our city for all of us to work together. There have been congregations that have been stepping up to do hygiene kits for our unhoused sisters and brothers that are moving inside in the Inside Safe program. There's all kinds of opportunities around supporting affordable housing and interim housing projects that are going into neighborhoods. And it really is going to be neighbor to neighbor, resident to resident, to make sure that we get this message across. So hopefully you answered the poll question to get more information. We're going to be following up with you, and we'll be connecting you with someone in our team, because we do have a great team that's all over the city, working with residents, neighbors, stakeholders, business owners, everybody who wants to be at the table. So we'll be following up with you really soon to let you know how you can best engage in all the work that we're doing together.
Thank you very much, Deputy Mayor Rivera. Well, this wraps up our call, and let me just say that I know I always appreciate these opportunities to hear from you. I appreciate all of you who wrote messages in the queue. And we will do this again, but we're really trying to test it out this time to see if this worked for you. You know, whether you answered the poll question or not, you can always shoot us an email, you know, give us a call. Let us know. Let us know how we're doing. Let us know if there is an encampment by calling 311. We have our outreach teams that are out there trying to identify encampments, but we want to hear from you as well. You can also call the mayor's office at 213-978-0600. 213-978-0600. Thank you so much for taking your time with us this evening, and we look forward to talking to you again in the near future.